Hello, Internet. Brian here for Work to Game Videos, and welcome to the Select Start podcast. Joining me today is my co-host, Chris.
Hey, guys. Happy to be here.
And today we're going to be talking about basically binge gaming. So obviously this topic has been brought about by Chris's persistence with Titanfall 2 and my intrinsic love of Final Fantasy 15. So we're going to basically talking about binge gaming and the effects on it and what are our real general thoughts about it as well. So stick around. Let's go ahead and select start.
Back. And before we get to the main topic, I think it will be related to what I'm about to ask you. What have you been doing lately?
I have been just consuming Final Fantasy 15 and absolutely loving it. I did just a simple little video kind of about how I'm playing on the Xbox One, and I've got the kind of the Elite or the Pro controller and how I've kind of configured that, because like my only complaint about the game is kind of like you really can't fully customize your control scheme, and especially coming off of 14 where you can for various reasons. Here it's like, oh man, if I could make this do it in this case, like I want my trigger to function as my lock on, but if I switch them, you know, anyway. So been just outside of that one issue and obviously making that one video, I am just loving it. And so every opportunity, like I'll come home from work for my lunch break, I'll eat really quick, and then I'll go play for 40 minutes before I have to go back to the office, and vice versa. So I would absolutely say, especially as it relates to the bigger topic of the podcast tonight, is that I'm in that binge kind of mode. Like I'm consuming it so much, and it's that way for me every time like a mainline Final Fantasy game comes out. Same kind of concept almost with the Final Fantasy 14 patch and a Final Fantasy, you know, like and even obviously an expansion. There's just this sense of this excitement that leads me to it. So that's it. I mean, I'm also still playing a little Final Fantasy 14. My nephew came over this weekend, and he never played Overwatch before, so I helped him get set up in Overwatch, and he had an absolute blast. And then he also wanted to play 15 and just loved it as well. And so from a 13-year-old kid's perspective, he he just was just all about Final Fantasy 15, and he doesn't have an Xbox One S or Xbox One yet, and he's hoping to be able to pick that up hopefully he's hoping for Christmas. I'm like, I'm hoping for you too, buddy, but I'm not that that generous of an individual to be able to do that for him. I figured I'm hoping that it's like his parents will be able to do something, and they'll probably get him a copy of Overwatch or the game or something for Christmas. But man, I tell you, I can't tell you good how amazing 15 is. And man, you know, it just, if anybody out there that's still on the fence or hasn't had the opportunity, it's really, really a fantastic game. They've done such a good job at, when you compare it to especially the last entry in the series, the mainline, from a story perspective of 13, this so far has been blowing it out of the water. There might be some plot holes, there might be some gaps and things like that happen later, because I'm only 15 hours in. So what am I playing? What am I binging? All at 15 hours over the course of a week. I think that seems pretty healthy with everything else that we have going on in our lives. But monologuing aside about Final Fantasy 15, Chris, I think I know the answer. I think everybody does. What are you playing?
I have also been binging. I have been playing Titanfall 2 just a ridiculous amount. And I am enjoying the crap out of it. I have almost every single gun to the point where I have two primary mods on it. I almost have my second Titan to Gen 2. I've been playing with all of them. I've obviously been coming out with some videos on that as I've started to literally try every style of play. I'm enjoying it so much, and they're adding more content, and they finally added stats, and they are adding maps, and I'm loving it. And then I also yesterday set up Minecraft. So I think I'm going to be getting back into that a little bit, because, you know, when I'm playing 15 hours a week of video games and I'm behind at work and I'm putting in extra hours, I should pick up a second game.
Yes.
That's clearly the answer.
That sounds like the healthy, you know, like, hey, you know, I don't have enough time to sleep. What can I fill that?
It's that middle school teacher saying, I'm just not challenged enough is the problem. Just play more video games. I would be a better balanced human being. So that's what I've been doing lately.
Now, on another topic, though, because, like, you know, so we've been, you know, kind of branching also and talking about technology, and we had a specific podcast that was kind of focusing on that. But you said something special arrived on your doorstep. Is there?
I did. I was trying to decide if I should bring that up now or if I should bring it up in a video separate.
I think it you know, deserves its own video. But I think also that, you know, from a little behind the scenes shop, that the podcast isn't necessarily the most viewed video that we have, you know, on the channel. And so essentially, I think, you know, for the listening audience who does follow the podcast, you can kind of give them a preview of the video that you're going to be making. I'm just excited for you. I'm really like, you know, it's always cool getting new technology, you know, even if like, so
it's very cool. It's very cool. So this morning I got a notification on my phone confirming that a large amount of money had been removed from my account. And then I got a email saying that there was an item waiting to be picked up. And then I got a text message waiting for my wife, who also got that email, who said she was squealing at work. She went by after work to the Apple store, which was madness in the middle of December, and picked up our box, came home, waited patiently for me to get home from work, and we unboxed our MacBook Pro.
Nice.
So the space gray is absolutely stunning, and we opened it up and pulled off the sheet, and it started. It just did its thing. And even with us talking and chatting, and she had to go get her credit card because we were going to go ahead and set up Apple Pay, it only took 8 minutes to set up. But then I spent another 52 minutes playing with it before I finally got on with Brian to record this podcast.
Now, tell me and be honest, like, you let Claire, because this is her laptop, you let her get her hands on with it too.
She unboxed it. She set it up first. I then put on my Touch ID. Then she's playing with it right now. It is her computer. Currently, her laptop had kind of been on the outs, and so for a lot of her bigger projects around the house, she does a lot of like Photoshopping and Illustrator, and she's an architect, so she does a lot of like side projects using Adobe and stuff for friends and family. And my computer's been pulling double duty, so we're really excited to have two computers again. And
well, also,
overall, my impressions are good.
You have like an all-in-one desktop, so that this also gives you the ability to, like, okay, if you need to really render something, your desktop should be more than powerful enough. But then also, you have a little bit of portability, so she can be working, y'all can be hanging out together in the, you know, living room. I mean, it's that I've, you know, if you can afford it, like, this is obviously like more of a like, hey, welcome to the middle class. That it's like, oh yeah, you know, you can have a desktop computer and a laptop that's, you know, maybe you even have a tablet and a smartphone. It's like you have all these devices and things like that, and it's good that they're, but I'm super excited for you. That I've heard you know, so obviously I'm interested you know, after several weeks, about what y'all's opinion when you've lived and really got to experience the touch bar. You know, it's like, what does that mean? Because essentially,
it's
like
very impressive.
Mm-hmm. I think
it's very impressive. Nice. When you need to be doing the Touch ID thing, it tells you where to put your thumb. And then down on the OLED, it has a little arrow saying, put your finger here, and the arrow is moving. Mm-hmm. And like when a notification pops up on your computer, the allow button is also right there on your OLED bar. And it's the escape button is still there. That was a big complaint that I had heard. People like, well, what about my escape button? It defaults to having an escape button. It's very easy to turn the volume up and down. It's very easy to turn the brightness up and down. My only disappointment so far, you know, I played with it for 1 hour, is it's fast, it's responsive. I love the OLED. I love the brightness. I love the overall strength of the machine. I like how light it feels. I'm impressed with the little bit of battery life that we've already seen. It came out of the box at full. It's still at full. But the Touch ID was presented as you can unlock your computer And I think a lawyer wrote that. What they mean is if your computer goes into screensaver mode, you can wake it up from that with Touch ID.
Okay.
But if you have two users, while they can each have that ability, you cannot jump from one user to another user with only your finger. You must enter the password. Which is kind of a bummer because that was really the selling point on why we got the OLED bar was that if I want to use her laptop in the living room, I can just go over and touch the Touch ID, flip it over to my side, pull up my browser. I'm not messing with any of her stuff. When she comes home, she does the Touch ID, never even knows my browser window was open, jumps right over and is immediately back exactly where it left it. So I don't feel like I'm encroaching on her space.
Right.
Interesting. That was a little disappointing. But
well, you never know. I mean, that's something that can be added with just an update of the operating system.
Yes, it's absolutely a security.
They can remove it instantly. Yeah, the hardware. It could be like as simple as a setting saying, "Hey, do you want to have you know with Touch ID, et cetera?"
So. Right. Mm. So we have every setting.
You should probably look into that. You know,
so maybe. We have every setting unlocked for Touch ID. That setting is currently not available.
Okay,
but I will say. Without even changing the size of your dialog box, there's room for one more checkbox there, Apple. You could give me my one extra checkbox.
Just one, yes. Because out of our huge audience for the podcast, Apple is one of the subscribers. One day.
I appreciate you guys tuning in before your next event, Apple. And I would really appreciate if this was the moment that you realized one more checkbox was what needed to happen.
Well,
So with that. I am looking forward to getting down on that computer more,
mm-hmm.
but
I'm hoping
I think
that
we
you,
need
I'm hoping
to,
that you can install a couple of things. Like obviously we play Final Fantasy 14 together. You play Final Fantasy 14 on the Mac. I'd be interested to see, and you can always uninstall because it is Claire's laptop. I don't want you to encroach in on her space, you know, because you know I want to make sure that I respect that, and rather than like Chris, all right, you got to test this on your wife's laptop now. But I would like to see what happens when, like, if you have the opportunity to install Final Fantasy 14 on that, and then kind of see how it feels from that game perspective, that laptop versus obviously your iMac, and if it sucks or if you're not really going to ever use it for that, well then just uninstall it. I mean, it's but that'd be one test I'd like to see, even if you're able to do something. Can you like capture video off of that with your capture card?
So you don't actually have to have a capture card for a computer. You can run it natively as a second application. So
I'm talking about a capture card to capture the video, like to record, so you can kind of, I don't know, like visibly compare, like the, you know, so how you capture like your Xbox, like
you can capture that right here on the. I use ScreenFlick. It's a paid service. I use ScreenFlick right here on my iMac, and that's how I capture when I play anything on my iMac.
Okay.
I didn't even know that was an option to capture my consoles.
Well, there you go. See,
I use an Elgato capture card for anything that would be played on the TV, but I actually have ScreenFlick capturing anything I want on the computer.
Very nice. Cool. Well, all right. Well, with that, learning about ScreenFlick, Chris got his, they got their MacBook Pro, talking about Final Fantasy 15 and Titanfall. So now I guess we're going to take a break, and we'll come back. We're going to be talking about binge gaming, and what are we thinking about it? And we're obviously guilty of it, but what's the good, what's the bad, about it. So stick around. We'll be right back. Everybody, we're back. Thanks for sticking with us. So, like we said before the break, talking about binge gaming, the good, the bad, the ugly. So, Chris, you have essentially, like I said, like you lived the video game vacation dream when you went down and hung out with Adam, who was on last week's podcast. Thanks, Adam, for joining us. But, and you guys played Titanfall so much. It was so, I was like, man, that just sounds like a really cool vacation with a video game. So I'm going to throw to you, binge gaming. What are you, there's positives and negatives. break it down what you're thinking about.
I am absolutely a binge gamer. I absolutely will play every chance I get, especially if a game is really holding my interest. As a matter of fact, I'm a binge gamer to a fault, mm-hmm. where something after 6-8 months, I'm ready for the next game and I'll just jump. So for binge gaming, I think that it really lets you get much better, much quicker playing a game regularly for large amounts of time over a brief sprint, like playing Final Fantasy an hour a night every day for a month. You're going to know your class better than just playing every few weeks and eventually getting to the same play time.
Right.
So I think binge gaming from the standpoint of a gamer, really, you get to see a lot of results and you get to see them in a relatively short amount of actual calendar time. So all of a sudden after 2 weeks, somebody plays with you and they're like, wow, you've gotten really good. It's like, well, yeah, I'm 87 hours in. But the downside of that is it puts the game through a gauntlet that it was never designed to do. And so sometimes I remember being in, you know, high school and you save up, you buy a game, you're really excited, you're overexcited, you have this week off school, and you binge it, and by Thursday, it's done, and there's nothing left. And now you're like, oh God, I can't afford another game until March. Why did I not sleep these nights so that it would have lasted an extra week? Why did I stay up until 4 a.m. and then wake back up with an alarm at 8?
Why do you? Like, I, you know, for the topic in of itself, what is it about that, especially that new game, that compels you to have to almost stay up to put that logical, especially now as an adult, but even, you know, even more so now as an adult than it was as a teenager. But
okay,
yeah, think about that. So, like, what is it? What is it about? Because I'm in the same boat.
But I have my answer, and I'm going to throw it back to you because okay. You can't have the same answer as me. you
this
have
is the, this is the
a wife and a daughter, and don't have a whole lot of personal friends who are able to play Final Fantasy 15 as much as you, if they even have it already.
Right.
I, on the other hand, grew up with two brothers. We shared an Xbox. So every moment that they slept in was a moment you got free game time, because we had a rule in our house where the moment that there's two brothers that want to be on the same console, a timer starts and you play 1 hour, then I play 1 hour. You throw a third brother into the mix, now you're getting 2 hours off, 1 hour on. Mm-hmm. So if you sleep in till 10, and, you know, if Adam sleeps until 10 and Todd sleeps until 10 and I wake up at 8, I get 2 hours free. Then at 10, when they wake up, I still get to play till 11. And so you kind of get this, I've got to get ahead, and you're being competitive because we're playing through the same RPG. So it's like, oh yeah, I was at that boss like days ago. And so it's absolutely about, I don't want the surprises spoiled and I do want to win. And so I just want to get ahead. And even in first person shooters, you know, in game night and stuff, you'll notice sometimes occasionally it'll be literally the three of us topping the board and we're still competitive with each other. It's still like, wow, Todd, way to bring up the rear in third, you know, and we'll just bash each other like, well, Adam's up top, but he's got no assists. We carried you. And so we just, it's that competitive nature. In an RPG, I don't want the surprises spoiled. In a ladder-based game or a competitive PvP game, I want to be the best one. And I feel the need to always be on the edge of content. And WoW cemented that.
Yeah. Absolutely. Because the same thing kind of with 14, it's like being on the edge. Like, you can even make sometimes like, oh, well, you know, if you wait and you don't like binge it, if you take patches off, you can come back and you're going to scale up much faster and get to that same, at least get to that spot where you kind of, you're at that kind of that top tier position. But I actually like how they've kind of structured that, because there is that excitement about being the best and the top of the kind of the class or your job within any kind of game. So like you kind of mentioned that, but same thing applies obviously with MMO. It's like, oh, you've got the highest gear score, you're able to go and run the hardest content and succeed at it and be, you know, the best. And it's also, it's really cool, especially from a gear design perspective in an RPG, especially, you know, in an MMO. Oh wow. And then, you know, Final Fantasy, it's like, oh wow, how did you get that gear? Well, okay, so I haven't slept in you know, 60, 70 hours and I've done nothing but this. And that's how, you know, so you can do the same thing too. It's just going to, where it took me 2-3 days, it's going to take you 2-3 weeks because of the amount of time that we put in. For me, you know, binge gaming, I would describe it like back in the day on the old DS, like the DS Lite that came out with the new Super Mario Brothers. It was a 2D Mario game. And essentially, I like the 3D Mario games, but it had been so long since they did a kind of a traditional 2D Mario in that similar style. I still think Super Mario World by far is the best Mario that they ever made. But, you know, it was so long that it was like I was so hungry for it. I even described it at the time. I was like, I've been waiting for something like this for so long. It's here now, and I'm actually afraid that I'm not going to enjoy it because I'm inhaling it so quickly. It's like if you're starving and you're like, I just want to eat, and they're like, are you even tasting your food? Like, are you even enjoying your game? And so I actually try to do a lot to make sure that I don't binge in the sense. Obviously, yes, I've got a wife, I've got a daughter, and so there's obviously things that I don't afford my ability to binge in the sense of like stay up all night and play all day because I gotta have to go to work and I have to be, you know, kind of at my best because I can't just sit here and just say, hey, babe, new Final Fantasy. Yep, every 4 years, you know, it's my Super Bowl. you'll see me in a week. I'm going to be this guy, this homeless guy living on your couch, take care of the kid. But for me, like, I try to, like, incorporate Julie and Maddie into that. You know, so Maddie, I'll give her a controller and we'll, you know, I'll be playing and she'll look at the, you know, the chocobos and get excited about that. So I try to incorporate that. So I haven't had essentially, I think, what you've had on it. I do sample a lot of games and I do enjoy that. So it's that, you know, I think we've talked about it in previous, you know, podcast about kind of that balance, especially like as a married couple. It's like, okay, how do you set up kind of a schedule so that it's not like you're always gone or whatnot? But I think for me, I'm trying to remember, I think Final Fantasy X would maybe be, and maybe even Final Fantasy XII, those games that I took time off of work and just played and played so much that it was like you kind of feel gross and you're like, okay, I need to turn off this game. I need to take a shower and I need to go eat some vegetables because all I've had is like Chick-fil-A and whatever's quick that like I can run out or whatever will deliver to the house so that I don't have to pause the game at all.
Okay. So for a second, picture the other side. If you were developing Final Fantasy 15, mm-hmm. How would you feel about people who put 40 hours on it in the first week?
I'd feel like a successful developer.
So that's the goal. The binge player.
The binge player, I think, has an important role in the ecosystem, especially in more of our social media. So we're sitting here, I'm seeing Mr. Happy put up like videos about various like post game dungeons. So they've cleared the main story and scenario, and then now all this other stuff that you can go do in the world opens up, they're saying like it's some of the best dungeon design that Square Enix has ever done. Like the dungeons are just phenomenal and they're enjoyable. And in this world where it's a single player RPG, you don't have to sit here and worry about so much balance, right? You don't have to worry about like, okay, I got to make sure that, you know, okay, just because you're there, you know, that you're not going to be able to, you know, get the best weapon in the game. No, it's like they encourage that. I think that motivates me to want to get to those places. But in that case is that when people are talking about it and showing it off, it's phenomenal. It's an exciting. So I think that there is kind of an ecosystem now about that. And that's where you kind of see the video sharing and all that communication. But but to your point, and I think where you're getting at is that, so the developer makes a game and it's like somebody, you know, and they pour 3 years of work into it or more. And then somebody goes out and within two days, they've cleared a week's worth of content. And then they're just like, where's the rest, right? And that's the risk. So let's say there wasn't any real post game in 15. There wasn't all these bosses you could go kill and they didn't have any DLC plans or anything like that. You would kind of feel And if that was your one game, right? Your one game for the quarter, all of a sudden it's like, okay, I'm done. What now? And now then the gap comes. And I think that's where maybe more binging comes in play, especially when you have long times without a new game. If you think about it, like we played Halo 5 for a year, and then you get Titanfall and it's like, boom. It consumes you because you've had all this practice in Halo 5. You know what's going on. It's the same game loop. But now Titanfall is different. And so that it's that excitement because you weren't just getting a game after game after game. So we did have that content where it was 100% focused in on pretty much one game. Now the difference is, especially like right now, how I feel is that you look at, I've got Gears, I've got Horizon 3, I've got Titanfall, I've got Final Fantasy 15, I've got four new games all within the span of like 2.5 months.
I need a
video game vacation. Like,
I think that as a developer, some part of me would be sad. And I think that's why you see developers starting to do things like what the Hitman series is doing, where it's like, all right, my storyline's gonna be 13 episodes long. Mm-hmm. You can have one. I'll give you another one in a month. Because I spent ages developing complex levels, complex ways of doing this. I don't want you to just do the shortest path of resistance. I want you to go back and I want you to beat it differently. Right. I want you, I have 50 different achievements for how you can execute that guy. I want you to go back and beat 10 of them, beat 25 of them, beat all 50 of them before I let you just go on to the next level. And people churn through, oh, well, I ran up and shot all the guys in the face and then shot all the guards in the face. And I was done with all 13 episodes in 5 hours. So that game was a waste of money. I think it's interesting. If you
artificially then extend it, there could be a negative detriment there as well. It's just like, okay, you're just waiting for the next content drop. And this is just something I look at, like, The Division, and I'm not, I haven't played that game, and it was something I was super excited about, but eventually just it totally lost my interest. And somebody was like, it's going to be great. It's going to be everything Destiny wasn't. And I go, okay, well, I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait 9 months. I'm going to wait. And if you're telling me in 9 months that very same thing, then yes, then let me go ahead and pick it up and join you. But if you're telling me that, they've got these promises, it's like, okay, well, a promise like to have these regular content drops. I've seen developer after developer try to do that. The only exception, and probably that's been critically acclaimed has been Telltale, who's been delivering their games in these episodic content drops. And so they seem to have at least a formula from, especially the reviews and the chatter, about the games are really well perceived. But I don't know, like there's something to be said about being able to have that game and enjoy it. And, whether you want to binge it or not, because the binging part of it could completely come with something that's seasonal. Like right now, the sun, goes down. There might not be that much going on at night. Maybe you just want to curl up and either watch a show or play a game. But, during the summer, it's like, okay, well, you don't have a lot of time. And maybe you're going out at night and going out and doing different things because, there's more daylight to be had. So, I don't know. Like, if I was a developer and somebody played my game and beat it, I'd be thrilled, right? Because I think they say that even statistically, like most people in single and games that have single and multiplayer, that majority of people just skip over the single player also altogether and just play multiplayer.
Yeah, anyway. And you have games like No Man's Sky where they beat it, and now they're finally dropping other content for you to build space stations and all that. And I bet a large number of those players don't go back.
I wonder, I wish I had some interesting statistics on that, because all in all, it's not. So, I don't know, like the last point I'll make from a binging perspective is that there's a big negative that can happen with that. Like especially let's take a game with a long tail, like an MMO. So WoW or Final Fantasy, is that you get into that binge, you hit that wall, and then you hate that game, and then you're angry, and then you go out and rant about it and say like, oh, this game sucks, there's no content. And it's like, I think then maybe the developer is disheartened because they're like, we've just poured a lot of time into that patch. with the intention that you would make it would make take you 3 or 4 or 5 weeks to clear all of it, and you're done in 2 days, 3 days. Well, we're sorry. we don't have that kind of budget. So I could see that where that could fall into the detrimental effect. But anyway, I'm going to throw to you, Chris, for the final thoughts on this topic, because we are at our time limit for
this podcast. I think it's an interesting concept, because it's like realizing that I feel healthier when I exercise, but then turning around and not doing it. I think binging creates an unhealthy relationship with developers, beyond the fact that it does put that hype out there and it helps drive numbers, so they have to want binge players. Mm-hmm. I think it creates an unhealthy relationship for you with games and what expectations can be, and doesn't give you the chance to savor it, but I'm going to keep doing it. And I see people, like we had a guy join us in Final Fantasy, and he binged to catch up with us. And by the time he hit level cap, he'd been playing, hours and hours every day, 7 days a week, and we couldn't get him to gear up. That was it. He was done. I mean, I can't.
He did it on two jobs.
You can't do that.
I was just like, I had that feeling. I was like, dude, you're awesome. I hope he comes back, because he was fun to play with.
So burnout is real. And so that's the question with binge playing. But that being said, I kind of want to play Titanfall right now. So I would have to throw it to you guys, audience. But let us know what your thoughts are. What games have you binged? What games have you feel like you get 27 hours in the first day? And what games have you paced yourself? And you said, I'm just going to get on and do a little bit each day or each Friday or something like that. And which way do you think made it more enjoyable? And then the other side of the coin, if you were the developer, how would you prefer it to be played? If you had to design a game today, what's your ideal player look like? So I think that's it.
Well, guys, for Work to Game Videos, this is Brian. That's Chris. And we'll see you next week.
Just kind of wherever that topic may lead.
Okay. All right. You ready to get started?
I don't have a formal question, but yes. It's only because I know right now I'm binging Titanfall and you're binging Final Fantasy XV.
I think that's brilliant. All right.